songwriters, broadcasters, publishers, labels, performers, because they can always be, often be at opposite ends of the issue. And the conversation sort of goes like this: raise CanCon, lower CanCon, gatekeeper, trough feeder, pay me, play me, pay me more. So actually getting up there all at one spot was quite a feat. Now, of course, the Canadian broadcasters walked out the night before, but there you go. As a former recovering broadcaster, I understood where they were coming from, but I wish they'd stayed. So we've got an hour and 10 minutes. So with six people up here, three questions each, times everybody talks, we'll be done in no time. But I'm trying to keep some time for people in the audience to have some questions. And I thought the talks today were fascinating, mostly because they came from so many different areas, and yet they sort of coalesced along a theme, which is just this idea of, first of all, acknowledging the physical and emotional pain of performing artists, and secondly, trying to figure out what to do with it. And then, you know, part of trying to figure out what to do comes from where it comes from, why is it enabled, how do you sort of, you know, start to get that crux right from the beginning. And Stephen, I'm going to start with you because you said something earlier where you talked about romanticizing the notion of creativity and mental illness. And when we think about it, you know, musicians or even painters or comedians from Van Gogh to, you know, Robin Williams, there's something kind of romantic about being very close to the edge, or that you have to be that close to the edge in terms of to be as creative as you need to be. Is that something we should be working against, or what?
Well, I think it's always been the idea of the mad artist, whether it's in the visual arts or, you know, I think anybody in rock and roll thinks of wants to be Jack Kerouac, right? And the destructiveness of the behavior seems to be kind of an acceptable byproduct until you're in the midst of that pain, and it feels helpless. So I think rather than vilify the mental health issues, it's a matter of learning. I think about this way. Let's say I'm bipolar. Let's say that doctor was right. And we have the curve, the ups and the downs. The manic times, if I'm writing music, most of it's either unfinished or not very good, and I feel like I lack the judgment to tell what's best. When I'm depressed, just nothing comes out. But having the knowledge and the memory of those things have been useful. I'm able to kind of remember those in the baseline times. That time in the middle, that's what I cherish as a creator. I find I'm the most creative then, the most productive, the most self-confident. So I've learned over, you know, 23 years of doing this to finally aim for that middle ground of active fitness.
Mm-hmm. But you have to come to that yourself, because right. The business you're in many ways, music business enables access. And you know, as we were talking, Anne was talking about too, you know, you go to the gig, there's free beer, you get paid for the free beer.
Well, and you're selling beer.
And you're selling beer, exactly. And in some genres, I mean, I don't know if because I came in 2 minutes late, you talked about it at the beginning, Phil, but when you won your first gold medal at 17 years old and got a big grant and went off to New York, where you worked with a drug addict, right? Yeah. And it was that normal? Did you accept it as normal?
Kind of did. It was in all the books.
Because it was jazz, right?
It was in all the books I read. That was that's what everybody did. And so, I guess that's what I should do. But I was this middle class kid from Vancouver Island, so it was a really bad fit for me. So consequently, I was not very good at being a chump because it was such a bad fit, right? There was so much conflict with my, the way I was raised and everything else. But I did have this romantic idea that that's what an artist should be like. And then as my work changed, and that kind of lifestyle had really no place in the environment I was working in. I was still living that life, but I had to keep it to myself because it was completely incompatible with working in the advertising business or working in, like the kinds of places I was, you know, playing in nice concert halls and doing that. I mean, you can't feed those.
I think that's more common. The hiding is far more common than just being outrageous or having outrageous behavioral.
Well, maybe now, but I know, you know, just from living in artists for many decades, right? It was like, it was sex, drugs, and rock and roll. There were songs written about it. They all went together. The industry, if you were on the road, you know, you can always find, I mean, drugs were currency. I remember trying to get a spotlight for one of the bands I was with, and it was like, yeah, well, it'll cost you a grand. And off you went into some foreign city trying to score just so you can get a spotlight. Well, what do you think about this whole enabling piece? Like the industry, well, I'll let you talk first, Bill.
Well, yeah, it's not just the industry that enables. I think society as a whole, you know, for that whole, I was just thinking about this, we're talking about the idea of the, you know, the outsider artist. It's in lots of ways, you know, I think society wants you to, as an artist, whether you're a musician or a painter or a poet, they want you to look into the abyss for them, you know, and report what you've seen and come back and go, okay, this is what I saw here, you know. And if that comes at the expense of your health or, you know, even death in some people's cases, that's almost expected. It's almost assumed that, well, that's what's going to happen. And I think that's, I mean, I don't want a whole bunch of sanitized, homogenized, very safe artistic expressions or experiences, but I think we have to perhaps, you know, I have a son, my son's 25, for all my remonstrations with him, he's still going down the same road. He's a musician and a poet, so he's going to do the same thing. And I see things coming up, but I try to counsel him more about, okay, that's good, and you know, that's where you will find these things, and this is what will happen. But you also need to have a strong self-image and look after your own mental health and your own physical health, because I think a lot of the times, I know, especially my own example, creativity comes from a wellspring of attrition and destruction, maybe at the beginning, and it's a way out. It goes back to the whole idea about creation, and that's why I really think that, you know, if we take focus away from the destructive part and put it back onto the creative part, that's where we're going to get some progress, and the enabling part is also down to people's expectations of what you're supposed to be as an artist, too. Mm-hmm.
Tom, maybe?
Well, I think that we become artists so that we can stand out as individuals and communicate with the world, to the world, with our thoughts and our vision. And I think that what other people expect of us is complete bullshit, and I still think it is. And I think that everybody on this stage, at some time in their lives, and maybe we're coming out of it, it's amazing, we're probably, most of us, in our 50s, or maybe close to our 50s, and we are finally starting to believe in ourselves again and trust in ourselves, because what happens to us as artists is the same thing that happens to the whole population, is that we stop believing in ourselves and stop believing in the power that we have and that the love that our heart can generate. And when we lose that trust in ourselves, we start to fall back on expectations of what the world thinks. So we become Johnny Thunders, or, we become Janis Joplin, or some sad story of somebody that couldn't make it. Hmm.
So when an artist is being very creative, and yet you know, falling off the rails a little bit, and you're on the road, and it's night after night after night of, you know, what's been described, relentless touring. Should not management or the entourage around the artist have a bigger responsibility to help the artist be the artist and not be so destructive?
Yeah, horse. The horse is still running. The horse has got bags of money strapped to its back. And if you put that horse, you put a stop to that horse, then the bags of money are out there somewhere in the field. Everybody's fucked. So the horse has got to keep running.
And the management has a responsibility to the artist as well, in order to like not waste their money on the road. It's the artist's money. And you have a, you know, Lal made a great point about days off. You know, days off are not days off. Almost never, unless you've got 2 days off. Most of the time, it's the whole day on the bus, cooped up with the same guys that you, at that point, only want to be on stage with, and that's it. And so it's isolating and it's exhausting. And as Andrew said, it's physically difficult. In the van days, you're sitting, not only driving these horrible vans, you're talking over them, and then expected to sing over them. And you lose your voice. And then the one thing that you have to show, like the thing, one thing that you do for work is gone because of the environment, travel. So all that travel is there because you have to get to the next gig. If you have another day where you're paying for bus and crew and, you know, eventually, hopefully, you know, truck and all that kind of stuff, staging equipment, it's just sitting there. That's expensive. And the artist view of the tour was, how come we didn't make any money? We did all these big shows. They have to justify that. So best thing they can do is to push it as hard as they can.
So the doctors and the promoters in every city, especially on the big tours, have the miracle worker doctor on speed dial.
Rock and roll doctor.
The rock and roll doctor who will come in and kiss it better and give you a shot. And
you get a B12 in the ass and a steroid in the neck, and yeah, then that's it.
And then you're on stage, yeah. Right? It's the same thing in the ballet world. If you're a prima ballerina, it goes down. Is that partly why they hide their injuries, because of the money?
Are you kidding? They don't make any money. I think it's more that the dancers will hide it because of what I mentioned earlier. They are so easily replaced. There are countless, innumerable little girls, little boys, all lined up behind you, ready to take your position when you fall or falter. That's why I made an allusion to the Black Swan, you know, that kind of vicious competitiveness. Yes, it's a horror movie, but you know, actually it's very true to form. And in dance, I'd say that you would think that companies would realize that they had to invest in their dancers early on, because if you're having so many injuries and dancers are out, well, that's going to erode your bottom line. But for decades and decades, companies just have not operated that way. They have more operated on the idea that a dancer is like a piece of tissue, you know, and you just kind of blow into it, then tear it up and toss it out. Because the end for most dancers is very sudden when it comes. It can be terribly arbitrary, and it's super, super subjective. So it's not even dependent on injury. It can just be dependent on whether you have a look one day that displeases somebody. So there's all these different factors, but this, it has been very much part of the reality in dance. It is changing. There are more enlightened dance companies today. I would say the Australian Ballet Company, for instance, it actually has a dancer's constitution. And in it is something like, thou shall not hide an injury, or thou shalt get thine butt kicked. You know, they are quite serious about that, but that is not true, alas, in our own country. And I know stories galore, hideous stories of just months ago of arbitrary firings and bullying. And even just a year ago, I wrote about that for Dance Magazine. Our own National Ballet of Canada had an unprecedented 18 injured dancers for all of Sleeping Beauty, it was basically that was two-thirds of the company was out, you know? And that's because there's an eating cult there, a lack of nutrition. It's quite complex.
But they have a beautiful cafeteria with all those nutritional foods. I've seen it.
They do have, but there is a mindset at the company about having a certain look that is emaciated, and that is quite prevalent today, and it is why dancers, even though the cafeteria isn't there, that's very nice eye candy, but they're being counseled, and they are being dismissed for gaining weight.
It does strike me that, you know, what we're talking about right here again now is around, you know, we have standards for the way we treat workers. I mean, actually, for a lot of workers, those standards are not being enforced. But for workers in the arts, I mean, no one even gives it a second thought. And you know, I mean, here's something to consider. Our governments, federal, provincial, and municipal governments, invest money into the arts. And I think they could and should put more money in. But one of the things that they're not doing, and I think that this is a conversation we should have, is they're not asking those questions about how artists are being treated. For example, and here, just as an example, our federal government is investing a bit more money in, or replacing money that the Harper government cut. They're putting it back in the CBC. But there's no questions about our full-time, stable jobs for artists, and the CBC was always that place. You know, it's like the gold standard for work for artists, right? Because you could get a pension, you could have extended health and dental benefits, you could be paid a decent wage, and you could be making art there too. But those questions are no longer being asked, right? What's happening is the money's going in, and it's going out to production companies who hire people on contract to produce a show, and then once the show's over, those people are back out trying to struggle for something. So I think that, you know, there's a lot of slack here that needs to be tightened up, and I think that, you know, our public investments in the arts need to come with a chart around how we treat workers in the arts, and I think that'd be an interesting discussion to have.
I had a real, when I went solo, I had a real crisis. An existential crisis about being an artist, because for the first time I wasn't inside the structure of a band, which was, although it was my own company, it was still an employer, and it was part of a major label record system. You know, in this country, a lot of the focus is on arts institutions, and what we end up getting are the boards of directors and arts administrators representing the artists and speaking on their behalf, because what they're doing is preserving and growing deserving institutions. But for an independent artist on their own, it's hard to feel, I find, it's hard to sometimes justify what I do as work. When I get up and I do a gig, and you know, especially if it's a one-off, and that's what it's, you know, an event for corporate or something like that, I kind of feel more like I'm working. I'm the help. It's good. I'm doing a gig. Sitting in my music space, my basement, writing songs, still feels, and this goes back to the idea of shame too, but we perpetuate this. It feels like I'm, it's masturbatory, or it's somehow, there's delusions of grandeur, as opposed to, this is what my vocation is. This is what I do, and I have to work hard, and that's my most recent record, Heal Thyself, is largely about that. You know, is art work, if it's something that you have no choice but to do anyways? Well, yes, it is, and what Andrew's been saying, really been striking a chord with me, because I think we have to respect our own work and demand that the world around us sees it as equally valuable, and not just economically, culturally as well. But when I was arrested me in New York State. One of the things my lawyers had me present to the judge was a breakdown of what income I had generated in New York State over the 15 prior years, as far as ticket sales, merchandise revenues, concession sales, and one of the big parts was union jobs. So those other workers who got to work with it, like that helped me reach a settlement with the court, but it helped me also understand that, you know, my showing up and doing a show has much bigger impact than I think most artists recognize.
Well, the economics of it are crazy. I mean, John was talking earlier about what the mean wages of musicians and artists in Canada. That's well below the poverty line. Until, of course, you make it, and then you couldn't afford to buy that guitar, and now they're giving you as many guitars as they can thrust into your hands. So let's talk about the pressure for a minute, because I want to go in a number of different areas. One is to maybe separate a little bit the physical ailments from the psychological ailments, and also just to talk about the nature of the artist themselves, because I've always found that, you know, the best artists, the icons, the legends, they are a little alien, right? We demand them to be a little alien because we want them to bring that mirror for us to gaze into. And so we do cut them some more slack. And I think that the pressure there, I mean, even the pressure, Tom, you talked a little bit about it, about the pressure when you're on stage and you're in front of your thousands of screaming, adoring fans, and then, you know, you go into your community and you go out with those people and not with those people. But I worry about, you know, what I call the celestials, the ones that they go out and they have whatever they do at the end of it, and then they're in their hotel room with the walls closing in and nobody to talk to, and they've just gone from godlike power to I'm now alone with me. That can't be easy.
Well, it wasn't at one time, but I mean, I'm coming to you today, Denise, as kind of something that's kind of come through slaughter already. Steve and a bunch of us on stage are probably, you know, made it through that point in our lives where we can make sense of it. When it's coming at you really fast, and, oh my God, you were in The Cure. So when it's coming at you that fast, I mean, how are you supposed to be taking in that information? How are you supposed to remember who you were when you're being interpreted by so many fans and so many people? You know, those hotel rooms can be brutal. I mean, I ran as fast as anybody up here, you know, from facing myself. But once again, it seems that the more that comes to us, the less we think of ourselves, and we lose the trust in ourselves unless we are that guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, sure. I mean, you know, that's true. And the thing is, it happens in most people's lives at a point where their brain and everything else, their whole psyche is not really developed at all. You know? I mean, you know, I was on the road from 16 onwards. By the time I was, my son's 25. By the time I was 25, I was probably, you know, fairly bad, really. You know, but I realize now, I only realize it, you know, from being in my 50s. But there's a lot of times when, you know, the door would shut and you're left with yourself, and you know, sometimes not a very good place to be. There's some other things I want to talk about. What Andrew was saying about the government stuff. There's also this huge, big gap that's been left by the changing world, because we no longer have big record labels, you know, which, you know, just like Tom was saying, they would definitely, you know, they want to bet on the right horse, so they're going to protect their investment, but they don't actually exist anymore, And the people that are in their place, like the Pandoras and the Spotifys of the world, I have big arguments with the people at Pandora because, you know, for all the money that they make off of the art, they don't actually reinvest anything into the artists. At least the old record labels at some point would go, okay, well, we'll sign 10 bands this year and maybe two or three will work, but we'll invest something in them. And there's no, so I think for young musicians, there's you're on your own, and you don't really have any fallback that like, oh, well, if I get, you know, on this tour, I get pleurisy or something, you know, am I going to be able to go to hospital?
Right.
Or am I just going to have to suffer through with it? And that goes back to what Adam said about, you know, having a whole bunch of middle-class musicians. Maybe that's what we need. You know, maybe we need like organisations like the Musicians Union to actually step up more and put that in perspective and put pressure on the people that are actually, you know, the whole issue of what we do now has become not so much a product, but like something to fill your phone,
right?
You know, and it doesn't have a lot of value in that way. And it's not like I want to go back to you know, exorbitant prices for everything. That's not it at all. But it has value. It has some worth. And it, we have to incorporate that into it, because if we don't, there won't be very many of us left.
Right. But we've already seen that happen. And there was a study done by the Canadian Independent Record Producers Association that said that 10 years ago, in 2006, there were 28,000 self-identified artist entrepreneurs in Canada. And 10 years later, there is half that number. Half. Because they're not making the money. If you pull that CD value piece out of the middle and you don't replace it with something, then you've got not only the psychological pressure, the talent pressure to develop it and maintain it, but then you've got the economic pressure right on top of it. You've got an economic monster crisis as an artist, right? Did you say?
That's right, I did. And actually that touches on what I wanted to log in here, because you had said you think about the Celestials and how hard it is there. And I agree, and we've heard some really honest testimony today, but I kind of think about those people out there, those artists, my friends that I know, who are, you know, looking after kids without childcare because it's too expensive. They're working kind of some extra jobs to pay the bills, and they're up till 3:30, 4 in the morning, filling out grant application upon grant application, and then getting up the next morning to do it again. And I think that that's the more common story of being an artist in Canada. And I think it would be helpful if we tried to find ways to ameliorate some of that. And I, because of, you know, how I think about these things, I do look at the macro systems, right? And the fact that it costs so much for childcare, and there's no access to mental health. Even in a crisis, forget about just a sort of an upkeep, maintenance kind of a scenario. And I think those are reasons too. So like, it's not just you know, that we're in a digital world. And actually, there's a lot of artists for whom the digitization doesn't touch them, and dance is one of them. I mean, some elements of visual art as well actually are aided by the digitization, but they're not. But their actual work is not. It has not been changed that much. But so it's the lifestyle stuff that I really think we need to drill into.
There's a lack of preparation for that too. My other son is a major. He's majoring in music composition and theory at Laurier right now. And so I've been talking to the dean there saying, why aren't you educating these kids about how to fill out grant applications, where the opportunities are, what you do after this, beyond the academic? There's got to be, none of us in the music business know anything about business until you're right in the middle of it. And that's a huge stressor, because usually you don't figure that out until you've failed or blown something seriously.
Being ripped off by your accountant.
That's right. Yeah. Or just not done something right.
Right.
Screwed up. And, you know, we are lucky enough, as much as it, I believe it's not enough, we are lucky enough that in Canada there is a government investment in the arts on every level. But we need to know how to navigate that stuff as we learn to navigate ourselves as performers.
Well, it's a whole new world, right? We already talked about the golden age of music where free access to the market would be fantastic because you could cut out that little man and make all kinds of money yourself and talk to your own fans, and it's turned artists into hustlers, right? They have to be
hustlers,
their own.
For sure.
Hustlers.
Artists are carny.
Art carny.
Not art carny.
Art carny.
But I mean, some of that is, now I met Stephen, I saw you in probably 1990 or 91. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're as quick as a whip, right? I mean, as far as figuring out how to survive, I spoke just a little bit, touched on survival. I mean, I think that either you're born with that, with those instincts to survive and to figure out what it is you want and how to get it, or you're not. And I mean, I take advantage of the grants systems in this country. I get somebody to do it for me because I feel that, you know, we could quickly become a country of fantastic grant writers and mediocre artists.
Well, it is interesting because, you know, Canada, artists have always punched above their weight, right? Personally, that's partly because of some of the initiatives that are in place to support artists. I think we could do better, as Andrew has said. But I want to get back to this whole, the psychology piece of it, because everywhere I look, I'm seeing pressure, right? There's pressure to maintain your health on the road. There's pressure to find that mental equilibrium when you're in front of an audience and then suddenly you're alone. There's the pressure to create, that to me seems, and I know this is not a medical term, but almost schizophrenic, right? Because you have to be osmotic, you have to be really, you have to be an introvert, you have to be open to the news on one hand, and then in order to sell it, you have to be an absolute extrovert, and you're out there doing the meet and greets, and you're on the red carpet, and you know, it's a whole other thing.
And the extrovert of the meet and greet to me is a very different person from the extrovert on stage.
Huh.
One is forced and one is totally natural.
Right.
My former father-in-law coming to see us play at the Rivoliers 25 years ago, the first time, I think there's something wrong with this kid. Because he's so quiet and introverted all the time, and then all of a sudden there he is on stage, the exact opposite. That felt always very natural. The meet and greet, the social media navigation still feels very foreign and awkward.
Well, I've seen artists actually get added to playlists by record company or by radio music directors because they love the artist backstage, they hung with them, they went for a beer, they whatever. And I've also seen artists get dropped from a playlist because they were so awkward. Well, either A, they were an asshole, or B, they were so awkward that the guy went back and went, oh, I can't stand that person, and dumped him. Seen a career go down as well. So
those are relationship building stuff too, which is a little bit old school. Like, I don't know anybody at Spotify to put me on a Spotify playlist.
Right.
There's no, like, there's none of that thing where there's a meet and greet with that guy to go and see if he'll get me on this playlist or that one.
Right.
As opposed to having indie promoters and radio station program directors and so on.
That speaks to, again, and you already said it about with regards to your son. But we don't train artists to navigate anything other than the actual work they do. So when I think about, you know, I mean, surely I've been dick to people too backstage every once in a while. Like, you know, it's a strange concept, and you have no roadmap. There's no roadmap, but you're expected to know it. And that's not just in music, that's in all of the arts. My wife's a visual artist, and it's an insane world, that is. An insane world. So I really think in our schools, in our universities and colleges too, we could be doing a much better job of training young artists in like in the tools of the trade that go beyond just, I mean, I just think like about financial literacy. Yeah, like most of us will probably have made major mistakes and now are much more financially literate because we screwed up. And why that shouldn't have to happen. It does happen, but it doesn't have to be that way.
So let me ask Phil a question here, because Phil, I know that you ran a music camp on Vancouver Island, kind of a bad band camp, right? Was it food and music at the same time?
Yeah, it was.
Okay.
Music and culinary arts.
Music and culinary arts. I was looking for it because I made a note. So what do you teach the kids at band camp besides music? Does lifestyle piece or have survival skills? Does that come into it?
Well, that was a big part of it. I mean, the whole generation of kids that didn't know how to make dinner for themselves.
Right.
And that was the main thrust of that. But it was getting the kids, we would go out foraging for food.
Cool.
You know, getting them outside, and also I had no iPhone policy.
Right.
Nobody could bring their electronic devices. But a couple of points that was something that you raised. At law school, we have a seminar on how to do a meet and greet. Like, they teach us how to do that.
Yeah.
You go and they show you how to talk to the senior partners and all that kind of stuff. And
could you show us now?
but you know, I find that very interesting. And the other point, I mean, honestly, the reason I even went there in the first place was to do the stuff you're talking about, to try to get involved in, you know, I'm doing a paper on exactly what you're talking about right now, about getting artists to work collectively to try to raise all the boats. Because, I mean, I'm in a bit of a different, you guys are over, I'm sort of the odd one out here in a lot of ways, because I'm like, I have an iceberg career. 15% of it is visible, and the rest of it I'm kind of working below the surface, doing stuff that nobody ever really hears about. But
but you're a businessman too. You have your own line of stuff. Well,
yeah.
Canadian artist, multitasker.
Yeah.
But you know, the fact is that we talk about the job security. You know, I had to undergo a medical treatment that went on for almost a year. I was basically unable to work, and I had to, you know, I went $60,000 in debt that year because I had two kids, and I was paying for my own psychotherapy appointments, $180 an hour, right? And I, you know, you get to the end of that, and well, I'm never going to pay this money back, because you know what? Because after all this time, I still get the HST credit check.
Man.
Right? Because I think by the time you take off your, you know, to take off your deductions at the end of the year, it's, you know, those numbers, you look at those numbers of what artists make and you go, yeah, geez, you know, I thought I was doing really well, but I'm really, like the guy that comes in, the guy that come and put my fence around the yard, like he makes probably three times more money.
Right.
Than I do. If I call the plumber that comes and fixes my pipes in the house is making four or five times more money than I am as a, you know, I hesitate to call myself an artist, but I work in the arts, and Phil.
He hesitates.
Phil,
right.
You know, Phil.
The Order of Canada winning multi Juno. How many Jillian records you hesitate to call yourself an artist?
Well, I don't know. I guess I always looked at it as more of a profession as opposed to I see these guys as they're driven to create their thing. And a lot of my work has been to help other people realize their artistic.
But you're absolutely one of the best in the business, one of the best in the country.
Yeah, but I still get the HST.
Everybody's got to do the HST. Across the country, if you're touring, you suddenly have to calculate different taxes in Alberta.
Anyway, yeah, but you
come from a family of lawyers. Did they said you're going to be a musician, and they did give you one of these?
Well, I have lawyers on one side and lawyers on the other side.
Yes, what I'm hearing too is this whole dichotomy with, I think goes to your original comment or statement about the romanticization of the arts, and you know, it really is a commodity. It is. It's been as such from, I don't know, from the beginning of time, but if you go back to, you know, even the scant knowledge I have of art history, you know, Gothic cathedrals, altar pieces, paintings, the Sistine Chapel, those were all paid jobs, and they were done with an idea, yes, you can be artistic, you could seek the muse, no one's going to stop you, but nonetheless, you are still doing a job, you're showing up and you're getting it done. So I think that that is something that, boy, I put the trope of madness in dance, because there is that built-in romanticization too of the mad artist within dance, even though you think you'd have to be totally in control in order to get it done. It's an interesting schism there. But I just thought that's what, it's sort of interesting that we're talking about, you know, it is a profession and it's okay for it to be a profession, and it is artistic profession. And it's one dancer, I remember a male dancer from Sweden Ballet, and he talked to me about dance being a proper job, you know, that's what they're taught over in Europe, where they are unionized and dancers have dance professions for life. And where the reason I was talking to him is because there's an old stigma about that you're a fag because you're a guy doing dance, you know, that's what he meant, it's a proper job, and a proper job for a guy to do as well. So it's maybe we're talking a cultural difference and perception, and maybe Canada has to mature a little bit more in terms of how it sees its artists.
Absolutely, I think, I'm sorry. It's definitely, you know, in North America, it's been delegitimized. You know the word I'm trying to say. Yeah, because it's not seen as a proper job or a real way to earn a living. And unfortunately, that affects a lot of musicians and artists who think, oh, well, you know, I remember making my first album thinking, oh, you know, well, that's it. And then I'm going to go back and make my, you know, I'm going to go back to a real job, you know, once this is done. You know, thank God that didn't happen. But it's like, you know, it's, you have to get out of that mindset that you know, perhaps it's, you know, Protestant beginnings. I won't say anything about that, but it's, you know, it makes us all feel that we're somehow lucky to do this, and we're not supposed to do it. We're supposed to be doing something else. Well, you know, I don't really want to make rivets in a factory, thank you very much. You know, I think I'd be much better off doing I'd be much better off doing what I'm doing. And whatever gifts I have that I can add to the world, that's what I should be doing. And I think, you know, it's much more important to see that and have the world see that, and the world that we live in see that, because, you know, it's perfectly legitimate. And you're right, you're absolutely right. In Europe, I have been to the best rehearsal room I've ever been to in my life, run by the government in Holland. And I mean, it was, but every musician here knows, you know, most rehearsal rooms are like, you know, old, horrible, carpeted, beer-stained rooms with no noise protection and cold in the winter, boiling hot in the summer, and absolutely awful places. This place in Holland was like state of the art, with electronic keys to get in, and a lovely restaurant selling lovely food, and it was all paid for by the government, for the people, by the people. You know, why the hell are we doing things like that?
Well, it's a good and bad. I mean, every economic study that you see on the arts, and I'm sure it's preaching to the choir here, but the economic payback for every dollar in, it's like $7 back or $10, it depends on the study. And, you know, Andrew was talking about it being an $80 billion industry, bigger than agriculture, forestry, fishing, all of it combined. Here's another fun fact, is that the amount of money that goes to live performance events of the arts is twice as much as is spent in sport in the entire country. Hard to believe.
And I just saw, this happens to be floating in my brain, but I did see a report recently about Canada, to Toronto, that more tourists come to Toronto for artistic events than sporting events.
Yeah.
They don't come for the Maple Leafs.
Well, that's a way, you know, to invest in tourism as a music cities would be awesome. I'm going to open it up to questions in a second, but first I'm just going to run down something that's fun, which is, because I remember when I used to be at the New Music, we did a special on musical ailments. That's how I met John in the first place. And we really did separate the whole idea of psychological, emotional health from the physical health of rock and rollers. And think about what your question's going to be while I tell you a few fun things. So Max Weinberg, Springsteen's drummer, taped his sticks to his hands to combat tendonitis from those four-hour Springsteen shows every night. He had seven operations by the early 80s on his hands. Billy Joel's percussive piano playing gave him tennis elbow and arthritis. Pete Townsend has tinnitus. Paul Young had cracked cartilage in both knees from sliding across the stage and cracked ribs from a fan who hugged him too hard. Simple Minds' Jim Kerr sustained crowd damage when he was wrestling an audience member with the mic and the guy let it go and he banged himself in his and knocked out his front teeth. Mike Rutherford, carpal tunnel syndrome because his double neck guitar was too heavy. Of course, there's rock neck, which we call a sustained strain injury common to heavy metal guitarists. It's often spread virally to head-banging fan populations as well. We decided that guitar face wasn't an ailment per se. Technically, it's more of a condition. Nodes are a seriously scary diagnosis. Vocalists apply a retinue of potions and procedures and prayers before they hit the stage. And singers, I mean, I work with Celine, she was like this. She avoided air conditioning like vampires avoid the sun. And private jets start looking like a bargain compared to the germ swamp on commercial airplanes if you're in the middle of a big tour. So, yeah, and right, for the rest of the band, if that good old B12 shot is never a bad idea. And while you're at it, you should get the crew done as well, right? Bend over, mate, swab that nurse, we don't know where it's been. So, any questions from the audience? Yes?
Andrew, you were talking about finance, banking, and oil and gas being very active voices. How so? I mean, what's, is it an association that they've got? Is it just a bunch of people getting together and saying, we're going to say this as a message, right?
Yeah, it's both of those things. It's both of those things. They have a very active and aggressive presence, certainly on Parliament Hill on a daily basis, multi-pronged, different departments that we see. You know, it's very, very well funded and very well organized, right? I mean, they have a simple, but their goal is simple, you know, is to just make money, right? And they want to find ways to make more. And that's what they do. And, you know, our challenge is much more complex because that's not our, it's never been the goal of artists. I think it has been the goal of all artists to make a living and to do well and to be loved. You know? I think that's a big part of it. But I do think that if we think about it a bit differently, we could arrive at a way of pushing some of these issues up the agenda. And I think individual associations, I know in the music space, there are various organizations, ACTRA, SOCAN, Music Canada, and in the visual arts, CARFAC and others, an okay job, but I guess what I should say is that if we want to get serious about actually changing things on a systemic basis, we have to get serious about that piece of it because that is a hugely important part. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. I have two comments and two questions, and I guess the questions are for everybody. So first of all, I'd like to thank you, each and every one of you, for your stories, for being here, for your talent, for your time, for your insight. please don't underestimate how vitally important what you've said and what you've done for us today. There's many different people here, clinicians, academics, artists, performers, people, administrators. What you've said and what you've shared is incredibly important, so I just want to thank each and every one of you, and I think we all feel that way.
I'll add three things, one of which is just to, yes, please, the musicians to the transition group. I mean, I think for musicians in particular, you know, it's almost harder to sustain longevity than it is to ever even have a big hit in the first place, which is hard enough as it is. The second piece would be to really, you know, we need a sea change in terms of how we treat music education in the schools. It's just so vitally important. It's always the first thing to go, the first thing to be cut. And yet we know, study after study, and even just anecdotally with our children, that it teaches them to be better Canadians, they're better socialized, they have better math and science acuity. They're just better if they have music in the schools. And the third thing I would say, maybe four, income averaging. Everybody in the creative field, like one day they get a big hit and they're like half of what they've got is gone, plus the HST. And then the next year, they don't have a record or they don't put a book out or whatever, and they plummet down to zero. And then the next, it's like this. It's ridiculous trying to maintain all those things we value as humans. You know, mortgage payments, children, clothes, food. When there's no income averaging.
Child support.
It would cost the government
honestly,
pretty well nothing.
Have one hit and then get divorced.
Yeah, right.
And have your child support based on your best year.
Fun times, eh, Steve?
Great times.
And maybe the fourth, just because, you know, Tom characterizes being on the road as being in a bar fight every night, maybe some, you know, fitness training at the gym. Well, I'm going to ask a question here.
Excuse me, Denise. Sorry, I just have one other thing to
put
in there. And unfortunately, I have to go because of my child care. I've started this organization called the Urban Worker Project. And you can see it at urbanworker.ca. I'm not going to tell you all about what it is, but you can check it out. But we are going to do a one-day sort of conference workshop probably April. And part of it is to make available some skill building for independent workers, which obviously includes people in the arts. So you can just urbanworker.ca and we'll be plugging in the details soon on that. Okay?
Okay, so last question, because we're going to lose right, we're going to lose Tom and Andrew right away. And I just want to pull it and switch it to a positive piece here, because, you know, what I've been very impressed with at the Faculty of Music since I, you know, reacquainted, is the amazing work that's being done here. You know, neurological studies, the effect of music on the brain, all the physical, you know, notes and hooking people up and seeing how they perform and how they can be good with rehab. And we know that music is such a positive force, it's almost self-medicating itself, right? That endorphins that are released when you sing in a choir, or athletes use it when they're training, or, you know, all that stuff, music used in rehab. That amazing crystalline silence that happens after the last note in a symphony and you're all held spellbound in that magic place. So I just want to ask the panel as a final thought, because we've talked about, you know, addiction, substance abuse, trying to self-medicate, trying to figure out what our brains are doing. Has music ever saved your life?
Yeah.
Good?
Absolutely.
Well?
Well, you know, I'd say to think I'm in the second half of my life, right? So, you know, with all those attendant aches and pains, and I've discovered in the last 5 years that drums are wonderful for, you know, keeping your physical shape together, you know, and it's like meditation. It really is like meditation for me. So I've got a couple of kids and, you know, I'm sitting there banging the hell out of them the whole time because, it saved my life. It's like riding the bicycle, but it's a much better way, you know, in lots of ways. So yeah, that saved me physically, for sure.
Tom,
then
you
can go. Oh, as many times as I have tried to drive my life into the ditch, from the beginning, music, honest to God, if I didn't find music, and if I didn't, more than finding music, if I didn't set that passion on fire for music when I was 12 years old, I would have been with a bunch of my old buddies at Barton Street Jail for sure, 100%. And even though I carved out a life playing music, I still tried to get into the Barton Street Jail a couple of times, you know. You know, I've managed to stay out of there. And so it has been my salvation. And still is now. And you know what? Tonight I'm going to pick up my grandkids. We're going to play some. They love hearing songs with their names in them. So maybe it's going to save their life too. I don't know.
Well done, Tom. Okay, you scuttle off, and we'll continue.
Well, thank you, everyone.
For you. Is this a question? Being a non-performer, that you want to take on?
Well, all I know is I have to write. And I've been a writer from a very young age, and I could not live without writing. So if I have any relationship with any of you, it is that I have, I guess, somewhere a talent was given to me, and it has been my salvation, and literature has been my salvation in my life, and I couldn't live without art. I devote myself to art. I devote myself to dance and dancers. I've never been a dancer. I just have a tremendous admiration for artists and what they do. Dancers in particular intrigue me because of that relationship between the body, which we all have, but how they can push it beyond anything that you could ever imagine.
Yeah, music certainly saved my life. And you were talking about choral singing, and I would recommend to anybody of any discipline in the arts to sing in a choir or play in an orchestra, just like on an amateur level. Like, it doesn't matter. For me, choral singing is one of the greatest things because there is I mean, it's obviously there's the science of it, the beats of voices next to you, and there's harmony, but there's also that idea of unison in your section is a really intense thing, and it's a joint pursuit of excellence, but it also doesn't matter if you're there. They'll go on without you, and that's a huge thing for humility and for understanding the magic of music, but your contribution can make it that much better. And I think it's the same thing in an orchestra thing. I was never a sports player, so I was never on a team, but I understand, it's the same kind of thing. But what saved my life more than anything else is just being able to be surrounded by artists, by amazing musicians and actors and writers and dancers who have changed my view of the world and continue to, and made me feel accepted and that it's okay to be the weirdo I am.
Phil,
the last
word's going to you, my friend.
Well, the short answer is yes, and it's been at the essential core of my life. I mean, with all the other stuff, the fact is that there was always this thing that kept it going. And I had so much love and passion for doing that. And the only time in my entire life where I really felt like I was imperiled was I just got very, very sick. I got like a psychotic thing, and I was so sick that for a brief period I just didn't understand music. I couldn't figure it out. It didn't make any sense to me. It was only for maybe a week or 10 days, but it was the only time in my life it didn't make any sense. And I realized that without that, I was kind of done because it was so important to me. It's been with me. I'm not going to say without it I'd be nothing, but it's so important to every aspect of my life that I have to say it has given me a life, definitely.
Well, thank you all. I hope some of this has been illustrative. I know that it's a very wide audience with educators and practitioners and clinicians and professors and all, I don't know who you all are, but thank you for coming. And thank you.